I'm Sudeshna. I'm a lecturer in the Chemical Engineering Department, and I'm also associated with the Earth Sciences Department. So what I'm going to talk to you today about is water resources in green hydrogen production. And this is one of the topics we cover for a module that is delivered by Chemical Engineering Department known as Integrated Hydrogeology and Sustainable Water Management, but it's open to be take to students from other departments to take as well, depending on other criteria. But so if you are here and if you're interested in doing the module, do get in touch with us. So the module is very resource focused and it covers the water consumption related to the extraction of different kind of resources. And green hydrogen production and implementation being one. As Mark had pointed out, I'll take all the questions at the end of the session during the Q&A. But if something comes into your mind while the talk is running, please put it in the chat box and I'll be able to see it at the end of the session. If a question comes to your mind after the close of the session, or if there is something we don't have time to address today or something that I don't know the answer right away, I can be reached by my email. You can see my email ID here. And since the session is being recorded, I'm sure it's going to be shared to all of you. And feel free to get in touch. So as I said, we're going to talk about water resources in green hydrogen production. The green hydrogen production is under a lot of discussion now. It's very much related to energy transition, clean energy, and our target to achieve net zero carbon emissions in the future. So how I will run the talk today is we will do a brief discussion on why do we need this green hydrogen and then consider it in the context of the water usage. In the discussion, you will see that the usage of water in terms of the global water reserves that is available is an important factor that we need to consider when we think about using green hydrogen, implementing green hydrogen in the near future. After that, we will move into green hydrogen storage and utilization. As you will see, they are very closely interlinked. If we are not able to achieve storage of this green hydrogen in a feasible manner, we will not be able to go ahead with the usage. So they're all very closely interlinked. Finally, I will give a short summary of the key points of this talk. What you see here in the panel here is the Sustainable Development Goals that most of you are familiar with, the 17 goals. When we are talking about the implementation of the green hydrogen technologies, it's directly related to climate action, it's directly related to affordable and clean energy. When we're talking about the water usage again, then we need to take into the context of clean water and sanitation, the Sustainable Development Goal 6. In addition, green hydrogen implementation will have important implications for sustainable cities and communities, development of work and economic growth, etc. So there is going to be a lot of impact of this new form of energy. Now let's look into the hydrogen demand assessment. This is from the World Energy Council 2021. What you see on the left-hand side is a very recent assessment where the hydrogen requirement has been taken into account from 2010 to 2050. And what has been considered here is that all our energy requirement, all the fossil fuels are replaced by green hydrogen. As you can see, three scenarios have been considered. There is a considerable level of uncertainty. So you see the graphs you see the envelope when you look at the hydrogen usage with the years. So it's a low ambition trajectory where we allow the temperature increase to go beyond 2.3 degrees centigrade in Celsius in gray. And then the medium ambition trajectory where we constrain it between 1.8 to 2.3. And then you have the low ambition. This is going to be the, sorry, it's the high ambition trajectory that's less than 1.8 degrees Celsius. If you look at this graph carefully, what you notice is all estimates predict a limited but steady growth of hydrogen demand up till 2030, where you see there is an increase in the demand and a further increase from 2035, where you see the curves going rising quite steeply. Why does the demand increase? Because it's also very closely interlinked with how we develop the infrastructure, for example, the pipelines for the transport of hydrogen. And that takes years, sometimes 10 to 12 years to develop. So there is a considerable amount of planning that will be required from our end to achieve this. So when we are looking at the hydrogen demand, of course, we have to produce the hydrogen. A number of routes have been considered. They come with different cost implications. They also come with different CO2 emissions. And they are generally, there is some color coding associated with it for the different routes. For example, if you're talking about the black and brown hydrogen, it's related to gasification of the coal base fuel. It takes place at a high temperature of 800 to 1300 degrees centigrade and a pressure of 30 to 70 bar pressures is required. And it goes through these three steps of combustion, gasification, and a water gas shift when you finally, from the coal, you get the hydrogen. And of course, you can see that there is a CO2 emission associated with it. So this is black and brown hydrogen. It requires coal. When it comes to gray hydrogen, it's slightly cleaner. What you're using here is the methane in the natural gas. And generally, you generate the hydrogen through a process known as the steam methane reforming. So this is a reaction that takes place over here. So again, here it is also associated with CO2 emissions. So as a rough estimate, you emit about 10 tons of CO2 for each ton of hydrogen. Moving on to other routes, you have the blue hydrogen, the green hydrogen, and the natural hydrogen. So when it comes to your blue hydrogen, again, you use the same means of producing it as the gray hydrogen, as in the previous case that you saw, SMR technology, but it is linked with carbon capture storage. So which means because you're incorporating this carbon capture storage in this whole scenario, in your implementation, you are reducing your carbon CO2 emission to a certain level. But what this technology struggles with is the high fugitive methane emissions to power the carbon capture. So you are adding another CO2 emission route here while you are addressing to some extent the CO2 emissions through carbon capture and storage. But remember, it's also associated with fugitive methane emissions during this process. Green hydrogen holds a lot of promise. If you look at the green hydrogen, it is a hydrogen generated by electrolysis of water. And the electricity is produced by a clean, renewable source. So that's the key. That is why it's known as green hydrogen. And you have this reaction that takes place in the electrodes when you pass the current through the electrolyte. So this is the overall reaction that is taking place. So it looks all good, very good, very promising, but when we assess it, we need to keep in mind that we have to, when we're looking at the electricity production by a clean renewable source, we also need to consider the CO2 emission that is associated in this route. For example, when you're looking at the solar panels, you need to think about the raw materials required to build these panels, which might include extraction of quartz and other materials. Then you need to think about the lifespan of these panels and then the potential for acidification through gaseous byproducts like sulfur and carbon. So it's not always very straightforward, but nevertheless, this looks very promising. The other hydrogen production route, it's not exactly production, but availability, hydrogen availability route that I think will be of interest to you. It's still in a very research stage. It's a natural hydrogen. That's the hydrogen that is locked in the subsurface, and it originates from different geological processes. And for example, through the radiolysis, the radioactive decay of water that's present in the crust. And then you have different processes where the minerals that's locked up in the subsurface reacts with water and disassociates and provide they convert into new minerals. It's a process known as diagenesis, but it also provides hydrogen as a byproduct. When you're looking at the geothermal energy, it's often seen that it comes up with a lot of hydrogen emissions. So this is quite, it's not being assessed yet, how much of hydrogen is locked in the subsurface, how much of it we can access. And a lot of geoscience knowledge will be coming here. And it needs to be used along with engineering knowledge. So for the hydrogen production, I think it's going to be a very interdisciplinary field. So here is, we are not going to discuss the natural hydrogen production anymore in this talk. We are just looking at the hydrogen production from black, brown to gray to blue and green hydrogen. This is the CO2 emission, indication of the CO2 emissions here. And it's also the two things is the CO2 emissions, that the other important thing is the cost. The cost is also very, very important. What you have here is the levelized cost of hydrogen. The levelized cost of hydrogen means you're taking into account the infrastructure, what the cost related to the setting up of the infrastructure and the production. What this cost doesn't incorporate is what is related to your storage, what is related to your transportation. And also you will generate some revenues when you sell the hydrogen. So that is not incorporated here, but it's a very simplistic approach to do a comparison between the different hydrogen production routes. Now, what you will notice here that the green hydrogen production route, the cost is pretty high, okay? But an expected cost reduction is going to happen. That's what we think. That's why it's so promising, by 70% over the next decade, so that it becomes comparable to the other production routes as well. So cost-wise, it looks doable. CO2 emission-wise, it looks promising. Although, you know, we have to take into account, because these are estimates, there might be more. It might be more sensitive to the renewable energy footprint as well. So those things are still on a very research stage. So there is a lot of work to be done, but yet it holds a lot of promise. So why green hydrogen production? So you see that in terms of CO2 emissions, in terms of cost, in terms of feasibility, it has a lot of potential. Now, always, when you're talking about green hydrogen, it is often compared to blue hydrogen. The reason it's compared to blue hydrogen is because blue hydrogen, as you've seen, that it's gray hydrogen when you combine it. So you are using the methane to produce hydrogen, but you're also combining it with CCS. So the CO2 emissions is expected to reduce, and because CCS technology is improving over time, so blue hydrogen, many people believe, holds a lot of promise. Now, when it comes to the blue hydrogen, just as in this figure, you can see the CO2 equivalent emission, and you see the blue hydrogen here, it has been compared to with other hydrogen production, as well as with oil and gas and coal. Now, when you think about it, the CO2 emission, one is direct during its production, it's directly produced during the development, processing, and transportation of the fuel. And the other one that you see it in red here is the equivalent fugitive unburnt methane that's related to the leakage, et cetera. Now, what is important to note is that this, we have a lot of methods that are being introduced to improve on this. What is challenging is the fugitive methane emission. You can look at it here. And then you have the CCS, of course, the CCS that is associated with blue hydrogen. And here the CCS is also incorporated with the flue gas capture. So you have two scenarios for blue hydrogen. And the biggest challenge is the fugitive methane. So the blue hydrogen might have promise, but we need to be cautious when you think about it. And that is why there is so much of trust and interest in the green hydrogen. Quickly growing to the green hydrogen production methods. As I said, it's electrolysis when water is split into hydrogen and oxygen by the passage of current. And this is the reaction that takes place in the anode and the cathode. This water splitting can be also achieved through thermal sources, and it can also be achieved by ultraviolet radiation, but we are going to concentrate on the passage of current here. And so as you've seen from the reactions, what you need is two metal electrodes, the cathode and the anode. And what you typically have is they are separated by a membrane and immersed in the electrolyte solution. As you will see that this electrolyte solution can vary. And depending on that, the cost, the efficiency, everything changes. So that also needs to be taken into consideration. And both electrodes are typically coated with the catalyst. So you can see that there is a lot of technical improvement that is possible when you're talking about the electrodes, the membrane, and the catalyst. So what about the hydrogen production and the water consumption in this process of electrolysis? From the stoichiometric point of view, for every kg of hydrogen, you need 9 kg of water. But generally what happens practically, it's much higher. It varies between 10 to 22 kg of water per kg of hydrogen. And that's because of the different technologies. We're going to come to that in a minute because the electrolyte solution can be different. And of course, the manufacturer specifications will also make a difference to your efficiency. So when you look at the electrolyzer technologies, these are the common ones, the alkaline electrolyzer, the proton exchange membrane, and the solid oxide electrolyzer. For the alkaline electrolyzer, what you have is a liquid electrolyte that is composed of water and liquid. For the proton exchange membrane, it's a solid, very specific polymeric material. And for the solid oxide electrolyzer, it's a solid ceramic material. And while the alkaline electrolyzer and the proton exchange membrane doesn't require high temperature, the solid oxide electrolysis do. And all of this have implications for the energy requirement to run them. Alkaline electrolysis is the most mature of all the three technologies that we are looking at here. It is also cheaper compared to the other two. The solid oxide electrolysis might be most efficient, but it's still now associated with high cost. And the technology is still being demonstrated, but there is promise that the efficiency level may be very high. For the proton exchange membrane, the other challenge here is the reliability, the consistency in the power supply. This has been only working for the intermittent power supply. So cell lifetimes is a big challenge for this technology. It would be incomplete to discuss green hydrogen production without considering biomass gasification, because this is also under discussion in many countries and in many scenarios. And just for a quick look into this, there is advantages because you're talking about a renewable feedstock. So why we are looking at it? Because, you know, for the green hydrogen via electrolysis, water consumption, the water usage just is something we are discussing. So what is the solution? One of the solutions could be biomass gasification because it's a renewable feedstock. It has got very low net CO2 footprint because, as you know, the biomass itself will absorb the atmospheric CO2 during its growth. But it has a number of disadvantages because the hydrogen yield is relatively poor. And the biomass feedstock availability will be very local. It will depend on vary from region to region. So if there is a transportation that is involved, again, the CO2 footprint is going to become unpredictable slightly. And also remember that the biomass density is low, so you need huge storage space and transportation facility to make this happen. So this is the reaction for the biomass gasification. Biomass you reacted with water. The water requirement is definitely lower than for your electrolysis reaction, but it comes out with char and you still liberate methane. So very often what they are thinking about again is combining this with CCS, but that's in a very research stage. And as I said, CCS also has CO2 emissions related to its implementation. So we'll stick to green hydrogen production by electrolysis, and we will look at the use of water and impacts on the global water reserves. So what are we looking at here? Water demand just for electrolysis, that's water used as a feedstock. Energy processes to drive the water electrolysis? No, because that's the very essence of green hydrogen production. It's supported by renewable energy sources. And we are not considering any cooling agent for the thermoelectric methods. So all we're looking at is how much water is directly used for water electrolysis, and then what is the impact of its usage on global water reserves. So this is a water consumption rate for electrolysis, 9 kg of water per kg of hydrogen. And if you look at it and compare it to coal, conventional gas, oil and gas, and shale gas, you will see that this value is quite high. You can compare it with conventional oil, but compared to coal and gas or even shale gas, it's high. So that is why it becomes very important for us to see if the water demand can be realistically met. So if you're looking at the green hydrogen production and the use of water, you need to consider the water usage in terms of withdrawn. Withdrawn water is returned to the water body from where it has been extracted. And then you have the consumed water that is more of a concern, because here the water is converted into another unusable form and not returned to the original body. So here is a figure that gives you a comparison. Don't bother about the absolute numbers. It gives you a comparison for fossil fuel energy, for the agriculture and the future hydrogen economy. But in spite of all the concern about water usage, if you look at it, if you consider it from the irrigated agricultural perspective or the fossil fuel, the total amount of fossil fuel, in spite of that, you will find that both the withdrawn and the consumed water will be quite low in the future hydrogen economy. At least some scenarios believe that this is low and this can be very much controlled. let's look at the, if you think about the water usage in terms of the water reserves that's globally available, that's a total resource. And you can see you have water that's locked in various reservoirs. It can be the seawater, it can be the freshwater that is accessible. It can be rainwater, glacial water, et cetera. And this is the annual consumption for electrolysis to meet the hydrogen demand. And this is by assuming that the fossil fuels have been completely replaced by green hydrogen. You see, you can make a comparison here. And that would mean we need 28 kg per person per day. And this amounts to 1.8% of current global water consumption. It's a small fraction of the accessible freshwater resource. Nevertheless, we will still have to tap a freshwater resource or purified water from other sources. So a tiny amount from the seawater, if we are able to process it, purify it enough to make it comparable to the quality of the freshwater. And then, as you see, the other option is to look at the wastewater. So 1/4 of our current annual rate of wastewater production can be used for meeting the water demand for green hydrogen. So there is, you will see, freshwater is an option, but what is important to note here is that seawater and wastewater can be other alternative options too. But when you're talking about seawater and wastewater, what we need to keep into mind is the water quality has to be very specific in terms of what we need for to pass it to the electrolyzers in terms of conductivity, pH, TOC, or total organic carbon, the salt content, and silica. So which means that if you are thinking of different water sources, for example, the wastewater that's been put under unconventional source or other conventional sources, there could be some treatment requirement. And that treatment requirement will vary. And then there is a cost associated with the different sources that needs to be considered when we're looking at the water demand and usage for electrolysis. Now, looking at the different sources of water for electrolysis, I'll go through this quickly. You have surface water, groundwater, and rainwater. What is important to consider is the water abstraction easy? When you get the water, is it of good quality? And then about the social acceptance. Is the water available in situ, or is there requirement for water transportation? So for example, if you're talking about the surface water and the groundwater, the performance of the usage for electrolysis for green hydrogen would be poor. Why are they poor? Because the permitting processes can be very, very complex, because as you know, the groundwater are strategic reservoirs for future water availability. And the surface water is very critical for ecosystem protection. So all these need to be taken into account. If you're looking at the rainwater, the main problem lies in its unreliability. It's going to be affected, we know, by climate change and weather conditions. Look at estuary water and seawater. Is rainfall independent? And also what is important here is that for the seawater and the estuary water, desalination will be an important process. Desalination process will add a little bit of CO2 footprint to the entire life cycle. But at the same time, the green oxygen that you generate during electrolysis can also feed into the desalination process. So as a consequence, what you will have is you can have an integrated system of production of hydrogen for energy generation. The oxygen can be used in the drinking water facility and for the desalination process. So there are some advantages there. And also there is a scope of extracting minerals from the desalination effluent. Not that they don't come with their own problems, because for the seawater, the complex treatment to remove the salts, permitting process, because you're talking about a coastal environment, and then you have to think about the pipelines because seawater will not be available everywhere. Corrosion of the anode from the chloride ions in seawater. When it comes to the unconventional sources like the urban wastewater and the industrial wastewater, they have good social acceptance. And because there is an existing infrastructure, there is scope to process the water stream rejected by the electrolyzer. So we can take advantage of the infrastructure that is anyway present for the treatment of the wastewater. And there's a lot of scope to improve process efficiency through heat recovery and green oxygen for wastewater treatment. And obviously the wastewater from urban and industrial sources are not impacted by weather effects and climate change. That things to be taken into account is the industrial wastewater supply can be unreliable. It depends on maintenance and somewhat about the production needs as well. And this treatment can be very specific depending on the kind of contaminants that we are dealing with. But then there are options in the form of seawater and wastewater that we must keep in mind for the production of green hydrogen. So what are the treatment methods? There can be various treatment methods like fine screening, coagulation, flocculation, and filtration, ultrafiltration, and reverse osmosis. Reverse osmosis is very, very common. It comes with the energy needs and look at the water losses. So when you are talking about wastewater and the seawater, and of course, we know that they have to be treated to get to that purification level that will work for the electrolyzer, but there could be associated water losses as well that needs to be taken into account. So this is what happens, for example, for the different forms of water that needs to be pumped and transported, they need to be stored. The storage can vary from the small tank to the lagoon. And accordingly, the volume of water that can be stored as well as the cost. So the cost goes down, larger is the storage tank. And the water treatment methods can be different. Sometimes it can be optional depending on the requirement and the quality of the water. So the water quality becomes very important. And finally, it has to be stored and then transferred to the electrolyzer for using. Now, as I said, right at the beginning of the talk, that green hydrogen production looks very feasible. It looks that we will be able to meet the water demand, but one thing we should not forget is it needs to consider how we develop the subsurface storage of green hydrogen. Otherwise, the whole thing is going to fail. That is why I'm going to touch a little bit on this. So the hydrogen phases. So you have a zone where hydrogen can be stored in the very gaseous form in the subsurface in geological formations. And what will be important to consider is the hydrogen density and the hydrogen viscosity, because that's going to control its migration in the storage reservoirs. So potential reservoirs can be salt caverns. So these are nothing but soil domes or bedded salts in the natural settings. And it's salt mining is a process that is used. So this is very much established. So the caverns or the caves that you dig can be used for storing in the hydrogen. And there are risks like soil deformation, but it's very doable. Aquifer, again, the role of the hydrogeologists become very important. I'm not going to go into the details of it, but aquifer storage can be very, very important. Hydrogen needs to be injected, and we need to have an efficient reservoir, like which needs to be porous and permeable to store the hydrogen, and then it needs to be sealed by confining layers. So it acts like a container, and you can also see the form of the rock. It's like a dome. It's called the anticline, and the hydrogen is a biogen gas. It gathers at the top here in the form of a plume. And finally, the depleted oil and gas reservoirs from where hydrocarbons have been extracted, you can inject hydrogen there, and it's going to fill up all the pore spaces and stay in there with the residual hydrocarbons and the water that's present. Here, the hydrogen quality may be a factor because you have other gases present. So the purity may be a factor, but it's still very, very doable. It looks very promising. So to sum it all up, so the hydrogen production, storage, and utilization is very much possible. So hydrogen can be produced by electrolysis, as you see here. It can be seasonally stored in different geological formations that we have touched upon. And then it can be used for ammonia production and re-electrification of hydrogen using fuel cells. So you can see that the electrolysis is being powered by renewables. That's the very essence of the green hydrogen production. So everything, once you have an integrated system like this, a green hydrogen production is very much feasible using electrolysis. We can meet the water demand. That's what it seems as of now. So to summarize, water electrolysis is the key to the production of green hydrogen. We have compared it with the other hydrogen production routes. This looks the most feasible one. We have different water sources that we can use, and they need to be subject to different treatment methods. And public grid water is particularly suitable, but if that is not available, seawater and wastewater can be good alternatives because it addresses the renewable energy need, drinking water supply, and wastewater treatment all in an integrated system. And all of this needs to come at the same time as implementation of large-scale subsurface hydrogen storage, which is going to be critical. So it looks very promising at the moment. Do you think we would be able to get to a point when green hydrogen would cover our entire hydrogen production? Priya, that's a very interesting question, and that's a very researchy question, because as you've seen in this talk, the scenarios that are being assessed is when green hydrogen completely replaces all the fossil fuels. Now, there could be alternative scenarios when it is used in combination with other renewable energy. And one important thing to consider here for green hydrogen is it's also quite reliant on how we develop our renewable energy source. Because if you are thinking about water electrolysis, we are hoping that the energy inputs is going to come from the renewable energy source, that's solar, that might be hydro, that might be wind, or even nuclear. So when you're asking that, will it be able to meet our entire energy demands? Yes, it will. At least that's what it seems for now, but provided the other infrastructure and other energy alternatives are also developed side by side. So it's not independent by itself. That's what I mean to say. Okay, there is another question here from anonymous attendee. Do we need to clean the wastewater for the further processing of the electrolysis of hydrogen? Yes, please. That is very important, because one thing you notice in the talk is that you need purified water that needs to be available to the electrolyzer. There are very specific requirements in terms of the salt content, its pH, its total organic carbon content, and conductivity, etc. So if you have the wastewater, you need to purify it. And that's where the challenge lies, because the wastewater that's fed into different treatment plants very often have different kind of pollutants and contaminants. So sometimes the treatment process needs to be quite specific. So that's another challenge. Hopefully I'm not missing any questions. The questions are very interesting, thank you. And there is another question. Do you think that green hydrogen will become more prevalent internationally with the rise of energy prices? That's a question from Eva. Eva, thank you. I can only answer that in a little bit of personal note, because I think there would be experts who would say yes to this, and there would be experts who would say no to this, because this is a very emerging field, but it's a very researchy field. So I would think that green hydrogen will become more prevalent, because I think our infrastructure is going to improve. And as our infrastructure is going to improve, it's going to be able to handle the cost. At the moment, the cost, the high cost, is also a major, major challenge. The technology is a challenge because it needs to be improved, as along with that, the cost that is associated with it. In order to achieve that, technical development is one thing, but a lot of policies need to be taken into account, the aspects of policy, for example, incentives to promote green hydrogen production, because at the development stage, the cost is going to be high. For example, when you're establishing the pipeline, so you have a short-term scenario and in the long-term scenario, so that capital, and from when it comes to the capital cost, depending on how the government approaches it, the energy companies approaches it, it has the potential to become prevalent. So I hope that answers your question, Eva. I have a question from Julia. Do you think we will be able to completely eliminate CO2 emissions in the future? So Julia, that's the intention. And we have to see how we do on that. I think one of the concerns is the energy sector. But because the energy sector also has to work hand in hand with the mining sector. So sometimes I feel that is something that is, it's getting the attention, but maybe we need to focus a little bit on that as well. For example, when we discuss, when we're talking about the green hydrogen and all the energy that needs to come from the renewable sources, but when you're talking about the renewable energy sources, for example, the solar, you're thinking about the solar panels, but that also needs a lot of mining of raw materials. What happens to that? So are we taking it into the picture when we are talking about moving to net zero CO2 emissions? So hopefully it's going to come, but it's a challenge. It's going to be a global challenge where everyone needs to actively participate. So it's an interesting question again. And then any other questions here that I have? Okay, so there is a question that's also very interesting. Are there environmental concerns with desalination? Yes, very interesting question. And I intended to cover it, but I didn't have the time. The main question is the brine that you're going to generate in this process. So what are you going to do with the brine? Of course, we are in this world, as we are thinking about reducing our CO2 footprints, the brine may be a source of other useful resources, but if we have to think about dumping it, the brines, like a waste, and where are you going to dump it? What kind of environmental footprint is that going to have? It is quite complex, but it's very, very important to consider. Because why it is complex? Because you need to consider the point where you're dumping it, the ecosystem there, and you have to think about the dilution effect. And when you're thinking about the dilution effect, again, it brings in complex modeling, because you have to think about the water flow, and related to it, you have to think about the temperature, the water current, etc. So it is a very important thing to consider, and complex as well. Any other questions out there that I have? Okay, so there is another question. If hydrogen production through electrolysis requires electrical energy initially, isn't it inefficient to transform that into hydrogen rather than use the energy directly. So what you have to consider here, if you're using, number one is yes, okay, now I get your question. So you're saying if you have the renewable energy and you are using it to drive the hydrogen production through electrolysis, why not use that renewable energy directly to and convert it into the energy or electricity or whatever you want? The reason you cannot do it is the yield. So the hydrogen yield, you have to consider the hydrogen yield and the energy that is generated per unit of that hydrogen that you're producing. It's much higher, okay, than directly using it for. So for example, the renewable energy, if you're considering the renewable energy, none of this renewable energy by itself will be able to replace all the fossil fuels. Whereas we think that green hydrogen has the potential. So that's where lies a major difference. Are there any questions? So if anything comes later to your mind, please feel free to email me. I'll be happy to answer them. Do the best I can. And also, this is one of the topics, as I said, that's going to be covered in the integrated hydrogeology and sustainable water management module that's delivered by chemical engineering, but that's also open to a few other departments as well. So if you're interested, do get in touch with the chemical engineering TNL team, or you can write to me and I can pass your queries to them, because it depends on your eligibility if you can take this module as one of your options. And just to give you an idea, I hope you have understood from this presentation that the approach to see the feasibility of green hydrogen implementation needs to be very, very interdisciplinary. So the module is going to be, the module is very interdisciplinary as well. So suitable for engineers, geoscientists, and there will be, it's important to consider aspects of social policy, et cetera. So it should work for students from different academic backgrounds. So you all will bring in your strength and develop in other aspects. So that's the general idea. So I think Lizzie is here. Thank you very much.
Hi. Yes, thank you, Sudeshna. That was fantastic. So if there's no other questions, just want to thank everyone for joining and hope you enjoyed the session. And please do check out the other links to our upcoming Spring in STEM webinars if they're of interest to you. So, thanks very much.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for your questions and thank you for your attention. Bye.